The next presenter, B10, Dr. Soong Ming Fung, with the title of Bringing Personalized Learning Via Learning Style Preferences in Coursework. So can't wait to hear from you, Dr. Soong. I leave this session to you. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Thank you so much. Can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Dr. Soong.
Okay. So I think let me just share my desktop now.
All right.
Yeah,
we can see your desktop. Thanks.
Okay, thank you so much. Okay, so I think I'll begin now. First thing, very good morning to everyone here, okay, who joined this session. I'm Soong. I'm from the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Faculty of Engineering of UM. So today, I would like to use this chance to actually talk about my group's UM Lighters project. Yeah, that is really about an effort of bringing this personalized learning by incorporating what we call learning style preferences in the coursework of a particular engineering course. Yeah. Okay, so I would like to begin by taking an overview of the current education scenario. So I remember that many years ago, we once had the 9 challenges of Vision 2020. And one of the challenges is actually about establishing the scientific and progressive society. So of course, with this, for many years, Malaysia actually wanted to achieve like, I think around 30% of its nation to get higher education, to be highly educated. And so of course, today we are at the year of 2020. And where exactly are we now? We have currently, of course, more IHLs than ever before. And according to the latest publicly available data, So according to the public available data from Ministry of Education, there is currently 20 public universities with 447 private institutions. And if we move on to some online scenario, we see well-known online learning platforms like Coursera, like FutureLearn, and also Open Learning, which is currently the official host of the Malaysian MOOC Initiative. So from here, we can see that generally there is now greater opportunity to higher education, possibly due to lower barrier of accessing this higher education. But of course, with any new opportunity comes new challenges as well. Yeah. So in particular, I'm talking about the increase in the number of students or indirectly the growing class size here. So for example, if you take a look at a rather unofficial observed data from my very own department, mechanical engineering. So about 10 years ago, 2010, I think we had about 80 to 100 students per intake. And I actually know of this number because I was one of the 85 students who graduated in 2010. So when we move forward to a recent few years, in 2016, we had 120 plus students who, by the way, will be graduating this year in October. And 17, 18 and 19, or the latest one, we now have about 190 to about 200 students per intake. So this is the number for mechanical engineering program right now for my own department. And of course, nowadays, obviously, a course is no longer taught by a single lecturer, especially for compulsory large course. And instead, it's taught by a team of, let's say, 2 or 3 lecturers here. So in terms of the staff to student ratio number, the ratio has been quite finely kept. But of course, sometimes for consistency purpose, which I think sometimes really is needed, okay, the course delivery, like the course material, such as the notes and also the coursework design, they are usually made standardized or they are made the same. Okay, so with this, we still see some one-size-fits-all approach in teaching and learning, especially for large courses. And this is really getting more and more unsuitable nowadays, considering the growing class size. And well, in other words, we see that some sort of customization or, let's say, personalized learning is really more and more needed nowadays in order to solve this challenge of increased number of students. Yeah. So exactly what is personalized learning here? Now, I think it's not too difficult to actually get the general meaning because there are really a lot of explanations that we can find almost everywhere. And over here, what I'm showing is actually just one of the many explanations. This is actually by the US 2016 National Educational Technology Plan. So according to this description, Personalized learning is an instruction in which the pace of learning and the instructional approach, they are optimized. And we have things like the objectives, the approaches, and the content that may all vary based on the needs. And of course, additionally, we also have the activities that are relevant, driven by interest and self-initiated. So this is a very general, very typical explanation to personalized learning. But of course, if we actually focus on, let's say, just the keywords, we can actually see that there are two major components of personalization in learning. The first one is a self-paced learning, and the second one is related to instructional approach. And then, of course, if we dig a little bit deeper, we can see other keywords like interest-driven and also self-initiation. So ultimately, the biggest goal of personalization in learning is to really give that flexibility, to provide the freedom, to give the authority to the learners when it comes to learning. So for example, when they are going to learn and how long they want to learn each time, and especially in what way that they prefer to learn. So I've already mentioned about the self-paced learning and also the instructional approach as the two components here. For the self-paced learning, I think there have already been quite a number of ways that this can be conveniently be embedded into some non-educational approaches like the blended learning or flipped classroom or modern tools like video recording software to actually produce pre-recorded videos to be hosted online to really achieve the self-pacing in learning. But of course, let us not forget about the second domain as well, the instructional approach, because to me, I think these two must work hand in hand together in order to really maximize the potential of personalized learning in improving learning in general. So what about instructional approach and content then? Now, I think one possible way of achieving personalized learning in the instructional content is really by considering the learning style preferences when it comes to the course delivery or the course content, such as the coursework design, which is exactly what this UM Lighter project is about. Yeah? It's about incorporating what we call learning style preference in the coursework of a particular course. So speaking of the learning style preferences, of course, I think logically there can be many kinds of categorization, but the one that we are focusing here is the VARK learning style, which was proposed by an educator from New Zealand called Neil Fleming back in 1992. Yeah, so it's actually quite a well-known and established categorization of learning preference. So according to Fleming in 1992, he actually proposed a few learning categorization or learning preferences based on the sensory modality. For example, we have visual learning preference, oral learning, read-write learning preference, and also the kinesthetic learning preference, four of them in total. So of course, logically, we also have four major types of learners by this categorization. So we have visual learners who, not all the time actually, but usually prefer to learn from anything visual, like graphs, charts, diagrams, and so on. And we have oral learners who generally prefer to learn from discussions, yeah, such as listening to speakers, like attending to lectures, yeah, in general. We also have the read-write learners who prefer to learn from text, yeah, such as notes and also a list of points. Yeah. And finally, we have the kinesthetic learner as shown here, who obviously prefers to learn from examples, from practical exercises, or basically anything hands-on, yeah, to get a feel on learning. So the entire intention of this UM Lighter project is really to incorporate or to embed this VARK learning style in a coursework of a particular targeted course. Right. Now, a bit of a background here. When I was applying for the UM Lighter project, it was actually during the July and August of last year. So I think most of us were actually preparing for the new session or the new semester. And by a new timetable arrangement, I was actually supposed to be in charge in a third year compulsory course, a large course from of the mechanical engineering program. It's called Instrumentation and Measurement Techniques. So this is basically a course about like knowing the instrumentation and measurement in various engineering encounters, yeah, like measurement of dimensions such as length, distance, and so on. Yeah, measurement of let's say vibrations, yeah, or movement and etc. acceleration, measurement of forces, tracking of temperatures, pressures, and many more. And by this synopsis, and also by taking a quick glance on the course learning outcome as displayed here, we can roughly see that this is a half theory, half practical course, which I think is likely benefited from some kind of practical coursework, rather than the very conventional written ones like the Q&A assignment or a written test. And actually, by my observation, a lot of this compulsory core course in engineering program, when it comes to the continuous assessment tools, right, it still largely rely on the written test, written assignment, which I think is actually not so flexible. Like when it comes to learning style preference, it probably will only favor one type of learner, like the read-write learner. So in an effort to actually enable the full range of VARK learning style just now, my team and I actually decided to actually adopt some kind of project-based assignment as the coursework instead. Okay. So this coursework is basically a group project, and it's a very open-ended design project whereby the students are required to design and develop some kind of a complete measurement system, starting from, of course, the hardware selection, the sensor and so on, to the assembly of the entire system, and finally to the programming, the coding using the software, since this is computerized measurement nowadays, and all the way until reaching the complete model or the prototype. So presumably following some modern applications that belong to the smart applications nowadays, like the smart home, smart factory, smart transportation, and so on. So a bit of context, for your information, all of our applications in the smart systems, they are basically sensor-based systems, and they which actually require some measurement of the data or variables in order to do some decision making. So these are definitely related to measurement systems and really really relevant to the to this measurement course here. So in terms of weightage, the coursework was given 30 marks, with an additional 10 marks actually given for an exercise for an extra software training that the students really require in order to complete the coursework. So we can see that the coursework really has a heavy weightage for the continuous assessment of 40 marks here. Okay. Now, exactly how this coursework can be related to VARK learning style and therefore achieving some sort of personalization in learning. So while it may seem to be not too different from very similar kind of project-based assignment, it is the group work nature and also the very open-ended design nature of this coursework that really enables the VARK learning style concept to be incorporated in the coursework. I mean, this is a coursework that really consists of a wide variety of individual small tasks, with different emphasis on the V, the A, the R, and the K learning style. So for example, when it comes to the visual learning, suitable tasks relevant to the coursework can include creating block diagram for that graphical software coding, graphical coding of the software, or even as simple as watching video resources and studying the wiring and the circuit diagram of the sensors. Meanwhile, for the oral learners or sometimes auditory learners, suitable tasks in the coursework can involve consulting experts for anything basically, and leading the discussion in brainstorming or leading the preparation of the oral presentation. Meanwhile, for the read-write learners, suitable tasks can involve reporting and all kinds of studying of the technical documents of the hardware, like even benchmarking using the list of hardware specifications, so anything text-based. And finally, we have the kinesthetic learners, and the suitable tasks obviously involve the system assembly and the building of the model or prototype, as well as some other things like functionality testing and also the calibration work of the sensor. So do take note that it is the open-ended design nature of this coursework that really brings a wide variety of tasks to encompass the entire range of VARK learning style. And also it is the group work nature that enable the student within a group to negotiate and arrange among the members to actually choose the task that they prefer or they like to actually carry out. So this achieves some personalization in learning. Now, a bit of information on the implementation. The coursework was actually administered in the second half of the semester, generally following a simplified timeline as displayed here. So of course, at the very beginning, we had the briefing of the coursework, and the students were also briefed about the VARK learning style concept, and they were actually encouraged to take a standard questionnaire regarding VARK also to know about their learning preference. So this is a standard questionnaire created by the pioneer Fleming himself, and is actually made freely available on his own website. So it's a standard questionnaire. Okay, but other than that, the it's mostly about project work on a weekly basis with continuous tracking on the student progress all the way to the presentation and the final demonstration of the working model. And to complete the UMLiter project, we also had some preliminary requirement of software training to the students and also a post-coursework survey done on the student to actually get some feedback here. Now, when given the freedom and flexibility, right, to do what they want, I mean, what they prefer in doing the coursework, and therefore having some personalization, what exactly did the students come up with? Well, some really interesting ideas. So I'm going to showcase like one or two of them. Yeah. So the first showcase is actually some sort of smart transportation implementation by the students with a context of urban city. And according to the students, there are pretty much like three individual applications forming the system, namely some sensor-based lighting operation that turns on and off the lights based on the environment lighting situation. We have the motion sensor-based vehicle detection for red light crossing. And we also have a very realistic parking slot indicator based on the infrared proximity sensing. And do take note that these kind of sensing principles or sensor components, they are actually being covered in the lecture, the regular lecture. Yeah. So the second showcase here is yet another smart system in transportation, but this is with consideration on the road and traffic condition. The students actually proposed something really interesting here. They actually wanted to achieve some kind of dynamic speed limit signboard, which changes the display number according to the surrounding safety conditions, including things like, let's say, the presence of rain, yeah, using humidity sensor, the environment brightness or darkness, yeah, using the light sensor, and also even the traffic density, yeah, the congestion condition, using some derived object detection approach here. Yeah. So really interesting idea and complete prototype from the students. Okay. And here is yet another showcase, but this one is regarding achieving a modern and convenient home here, with a few things like the smart entry indicator, automated lighting, and also automated ventilation based on the measurement of the indoor temperature, room temperature. Now, the reason that I'm actually showcasing all this is actually not just to highlight the students' creativity in ideation. I mean, they are definitely creative and definitely I have no doubt about it. But another reason is also to highlight the effort that they have put into this coursework. I mean, just take a look at the models that they came up with. So what I want to say here is that I think students from many groups actually showed deep engagement towards completing the coursework, and presumably due to the interest in doing what they prefer to do, let's say according to the VARK style categorization. So overall, I think that this coursework seems to be quite effective in improving learning. I mean, in bringing learning by doing something, right? But this is, of course, just my own perception, you know, based on my observation on the effort put by the students. And we still need some numbers to actually further support this. So let's take a look at some quick statistics after the, I mean, following the semester. Yeah? Now, the first one that I want to showcase is the course learning outcome, because the course outcome, or COs, is probably the important objectives of conducting a course, since UM has been implementing the outcome-based education for quite some time, right? And so for this course, there is a total of four COs, with the first two especially relevant to the coursework here, the project-based assignment. So basically, after when everything was actually done and evaluated, my team and I actually observed an achievement of actually 90% of the CO achievement. And this is, of course, based on the standard criterion of...
Dr. Sung, you have two more minutes. You have to
I'll just speed up. Yeah, okay. So following the standard criteria, so I think achieving 90% for coursework achievement when the current implementation by my faculty 70% seems to be quite reasonable and quite encouraging. Okay. And there is also agreement with perceived achievement by the students, what they actually felt regarding this achievement with the actual achievement here. And this is really based on a post coursework survey, which was also part of the UMLITER project. Yeah? The first four questions were actually designed to inquire how the students felt about learning related to these four COs. And here we see the consistency, which I think is a good sign. So we have the confirmation here that the CO is really achieved and the students also agreed. Yeah? And the next one I want to showcase is basically a survey, post-coursework survey, which consists of 16 questions actually. And the first four questions were already discussed about the students' perceived achievement. And the rest are actually regarding inquiries on a few things, like the effectiveness of the coursework in bringing learning, on the interest of the students to actually further explore a measurement topic even after the coursework, and also on the preference of the coursework. Yeah? And based on the survey that we actually conducted, the outcome is that generally there was quite positive feedback given by the students. In terms of effectiveness, we see that generally the students felt that they can now perform the steps, the setup of measurement system more confidently, and they generally agree on this. So showing some effectiveness of this coursework in bringing learning, yeah, of the overall course. And when it comes to the interest, I think the students generally feel that they are now interested in exploring the topics of measurement even after the coursework, after the course. And I think this is important because this measurement is often required in subsequent courses, like the final year thesis project, where they need to actually use the skill that they learn here. And finally, when it comes to the preference, the students actually send a very clear message here. They really prefer to have this kind of project-based assignment in comparison to the very regular, written kind of Q&A assignment. Yeah. Now, for my final few words, I just want to reiterate this point. Basically, my team and I feel that implementation of the group project as a coursework, especially in engineering course here, is quite effective in bringing personalized learning. Why is that so? Because a course with broad task distribution and also a course with open-ended design nature really enable that possibility of a wide variety of the learning style preferences to be made freely available to the students. I mean, of course, they need to negotiate and arrange among their group mates, but generally it's quite flexible. So therefore achieving personalized learning, and it makes the learning more effective. But over here, I just want to say that we are not proposing something, or we are not doing something totally revolutionary. It's still a project-based assignment, it's still quite similar. And we are actually just proposing a coursework design. And we believe that this framework can be adopted not just in engineering, but even in other non-technical courses as well. As long as the courses can be benefited from this kind of broad task distribution and open-ended project nature. And over here, my team and I, we would definitely like to see this happening. Okay. So I think with this, I've reached the end of my presentation. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, Dr. Song, for a very enlightening presentation.